Hi, video viewer. My name is Laura Levin, and this video is entitled Brecht and the Alienation Effect. I'm an associate professor and director of the MA and PhD program in theater and performance studies at York University. I'm a performance theorist and artist, and my research often focuses on performing gender and sexuality and experimental uses of space in performance. As a teacher, I combine my love of theory and practice in creation courses I teach on devised theater and practice-based research. In this video, I'm going to offer a short intro to Bertolt Brecht's very useful concept of the alienation effect and suggest some of the ways it can be used in performance training to denaturalize traditional forms of cultural embodiment and promote valuable skills in critical inquiry and political intervention. Along the way, I hope to dispel the common belief that Brecht's writings are too theoretical to be applied to theater practice. In fact, they offer performers excellent tools for uncovering and challenging existing social structures. So let's start with Brecht, someone who will be familiar to many of you as one of the gurus of 20th century theater, but whose work too rarely makes its way into actor conservatories where method acting still rules the roost. Brecht's work comes out of a Marxist tradition. He wrote against the backdrop of fascism in World War II Germany, a time when people were getting emotionally swept up in the mass spectacle of Nazism and were unable to think critically about its devastating effects. Brecht responded with a powerful model for political theater designed to force people out of their complacency with respect to how they saw the world. A theater that cultivated the conditions for engaging with social realities lucidly, independently, and critically. Brecht viewed realist theater as colluding with dominant ideologies like capitalism and fascism, which presented existing social structures as natural or inevitable. To follow Torvald's deterministic logic in Ibsen's play A Doll's House, Nora will always be a feeble-minded woman who makes poor choices and is bad with money because, well, she's a woman. That's the way women are, their natural state. Over and against this naturalistic rhetoric, a rhetoric sometimes reinforced in method acting when actors are encouraged to mimic life's observable truths, life as it is, we would say, Brecht set out to create a method for revealing the world's inescapable contingency. Drawing on Marxist materialism, this method spends less time seeking out the world's isness and focuses instead on the means through which reality is produced. Who creates a particular view of reality? How and to what end? Consider, for example, the highly theatrical greenwashing that big energy companies like Chevron engage in to divert our attention from their destruction of the environment. They tell us in print ads and TV commercials that they are eco-friendly companies. With smiling faces, they insist that they really care about the impact of their work, all the while continuing to wreak havoc on natural resources and to harm local communities. A mock promotional video called Thinking Green, Acting Green, created by the activist performance duo The Yes Men, which I discuss at length in my book Performing Ground, pokes fun at the kind of theatrical techniques that prop up this corporate construction of self. The video presents two appealing professional actors performing as spokespersons for the petroleum and plastics industries. Strolling in a forest, they cheerily tell us what they're doing to show that they care. I'm wearing a suit, one says, so I must love nature. And look where I'm standing. Isn't it beautiful? Hopefully, when you think of oil refineries, you'll think of this. His female companion, donning a forest green coat and whimsical pigtails, chimes in. We're doing our part to look environmental, but we need you to meet us halfway and believe we're environmental, even when we lobby against restrictions like the Kyoto Accord. So what does this satirical video have to do with Brecht and with acting? Well, to begin with, it's a great example of Brecht's central technique, the verfremdungseffekt, often translated as the alienation or defamiliarization effect. An alienation effect is a theatrical device that takes, in his words, a common, recurrent, universally practiced operation and tries to draw attention to it by illuminating its peculiarity. Put more simply, it makes the familiar, so say a typical corporate ad, unfamiliar. The affect does this by exposing the constructedness of the reality it presents, so how it's produced through theatrical means. In the Yes Men video, the actors create a Brechtian distance between self and role. They refer to themselves as actors. They talk about their strategic use of costume and backdrop and explain how they're projecting a palatable corporate image. By exposing this theatrical construction as precisely theatrical, acting green as acting, the illusion of environmentally friendly resource exploitation quickly crumbles, making it available for us to scrutinize and critique. And in this sense, Brechtian affects remind us that acting is not a neutral activity. It's actually a way of ideologically constructing the world through theatrical signs. This process is not unlike the ways in which we construct our identities in everyday life. As feminist theorist Ellen Diamond argues in her influential essay, Brechtian Theory, Feminist Theory, gender can be defined as, quote, the words, gestures, appearances, ideas, and behavior that dominant culture understands as indices of feminine or masculine identity. When spectators see gender, they're seeing and reproducing the cultural signs of gender, and by implication, the gender ideology of a culture. Brecht's strategies of defamiliarization give us the necessary distance to read signs as part of larger sign systems. And in this way, they can be extremely useful, I think, for unsettling normative conceptions of identity and promoting diverse perspectives in performance training contexts. Let me explain with a little help from Diamond and by sharing a few examples from the devised theater classes I teach. For me, the term devising, which suggests invention, creation, and a kind of working through, always already invites a Brechtian attentiveness to the means through which the world is constructed. Devising is in fact an ideal site for Brechtian materialist thinking, for taking up the promise of theatrically making strange. But what precisely can a defamiliarized devising reveal about the politics of identity? First, identity is not a natural fixed essence. As Ellen Diamond contends, quote, gender in fact provides the perfect illustration of ideology at work, since feminine and masculine behavior usually appears to be a natural and thus fixed and unalterable extension of biological sex. This obsession with natural sexual dispositions permeates our culture, but also regrettably is present in actor training programs, where the ideal neutral state that actors are taught to inhabit requires coming into alignment with their biological equipment. Men are encouraged to be more manly, and women more womanly. The process of ridding actors of bad habits demands that they banish mannerisms and vocal styles that don't line up with so-called natural sexual identity. A version of this fetish for the natural also appears in audition contexts, when performers transgress their sex as a biological given. And I'm thinking here of the unfortunate redirects given to gay male students when they choose to play straight characters. The redirect is often something like, do the monologue again as though you're talking to your gay lover. Or the redirects given to ESL students who are asked to redo an English monologue in their native tongue. Why? Because it will, supposedly, help them act more naturally. These practices rely on what Diamond calls iconicity, or the expectation of resemblance. Here, the performer's body is dubiously expected to resemble the object or character to which it refers. One of the best AFX for prying apart the lamination of actor and role is cross-dressing, a technique which calls attention to identity as costume, as product of a theatrical sign system. The AFX of cross-dressing is encouraged throughout my devising course, but is most often taken up by students when they're adapting canonical source texts. In these assignments, students are invited to physically decode ideologies embedded in classics like Williams' Streetcar Named Desire, using their bodies to tell alternative stories about identity. In what ways, I ask them, might Stanley's hyper-performance of masculinity in Streetcar become more visible as performance if he's played by a woman? Similarly, how might making the decision to have a single performer inhabit multiple characters, say Stella, Blanche, and Eunice, allow us to see differences within a particular gender, and gender as the product of class-based social conditions? And of course, if we're watching a female actor playing Blanche flirt with a female actor playing Stanley, the question of desire quickly emerges. Are we watching women desiring men, women desiring women, or both? Which brings me to my next point. The use of AFX in performance training also reveals that identity is a site of difference and contradiction. Defamiliarizing gender in training contexts almost always leads to questions about other aspects of identity. Gender can't easily be disentangled from sexuality, which can't easily be unknotted from class, from race, age, ability, and so on. Recognizing the intersectional nature of difference helps complicate models of identity that are based on a single axis of experience. My students and I wrestle with difference when we work on interview-based verbatim theater pieces, each taking up a particular social issue. I introduce this module through the verbatim plays of African-American artist Anna Deavere Smith, which respond to racially inflected crises in recent U.S. history. So, for example, the L.A. and Crown Heights riots. Smith's embodiment of her interview subjects, of men and women from diverse racial and ethnic communities, is an ideal example of defamiliarized acting. Her shifting from role to role prevents the usual expectation of resemblance and frees spectators to pick out the visual and linguistic markers that distinguish individuals within a particular city or community. It also offers my class an interesting opportunity to reflect on the limits of cross-casting and dressing as a defamiliarizing technique. The separation of self and role can sometimes give the impression that the performer is an objective observer of the cultural other. But performers bring their own judgments to bear in every cross-staging, a fact critics have noted in Smith's presentation of white characters, for example, which some read as highly caricatured. As Shannon Jackson warns, a performer's defamiliarization of racism when playing the other runs the risk of naturalization. In other words, it's as though the performer is saying, "She is not me." I teach my students to grapple with this problem as they devise, in effect asking them to defamiliarize defamiliarization. Working with the AFX can also steer performers away from oppositional conceptions of difference. Male versus female, gay versus straight, black versus white, and lead them to more expansive views of identity, what post-structuralist Jacques Derrida calls différence. I define différence for my students in the form of a tongue twister, differences that differ from a closed system of differences. Each performance of identity contains within it the trace of something that it is not, contains differences that may not even be intelligible within existing binary frameworks. The upshot, as Diamond puts it, is that if identity is always different from itself, it can no longer be an identity. Diamond points out that the Derridean sense of difference has a lot in common with alienated acting, especially with what Brecht calls the not but. When an actor appears on stage, Brecht writes, besides what he actually is doing, he will at all essential points discover, specify, imply what he is not doing. That is, he will act in such a way that the alternative emerges as clearly as possible, that his acting allows the other possibilities to be inferred and only represents one of the possible variants. So, for example, an actor chooses to exit stage right, but simultaneously shows that they could have exited stage left, looking in that direction before leaving. Cross-casting easily visualizes the not but. I'm not a man, but a woman. At the same time, the special difficulty of collapsing the actor and the real-life interviewee in verbatim theater drives a wedge between character and role, encouraging students to reflect on the alternatives each action represses. The ideological difference, for example, between calling someone Jewish as opposed to a Jew man, or calling an event an accident as opposed to calling it a crime. In physical terms, the not but emerges in tensions between saying and doing. In Smith's plays, we see it in the nervous stirring of coffee as an overconfident racist diatribe is delivered, or in the strange upward inflection of a voice just as a defense of one's people is uttered. These bodily stumbles cause the self-assuredness of identity to stumble too, exposing how the body functions as language's tenuous and contingent support system, to use Jackson's words. Most importantly, the Brechtian not but makes it exceptionally clear that behavior is changeable. It does this by illustrating that identity is the product of particular historical conditions. Identity is something that has changed over time, its signs constantly shifting with the flux of material forces. Brecht used the word historicization to talk about how affects foster an awareness of this historicity. In Diamond's words, one way that the actor alienates or distances the audience from the character is to suggest the historicity of the character in contrast to the actor's own present time self-awareness on stage. Historicization is essential to many devised theater exercises that engage with canonical texts and also offers a nice way to bridge theater history and studio courses. Each year, for instance, I invite students to remediate plays from past eras by fusing them with digital media. Students have turned to live tweeting when staging Hamlet to distinguish ideas of privacy today from those in the Renaissance. And they've created wild mashups of plays like Wojtek with projections from Disney's Alice in Wonderland, linking 19th century misogyny and views of young women to women's 20th century infantilization. Another way that I've experimented with historicization is by building assignments around what Brecht called gestus. In his words, a gesture, a word, an action, a tableau by which separately or in series, the social attitudes encoded in the play text become visible to the spectator. In linking gestus and historicization, I've been really inspired by photographer Jeff Wall's reading of gestus as, quote, the bodily pictorial form of historical consciousness. Gestus is a way of distilling a moment in time through a gesture or a frozen image, or what we might call the gist of the moment. I explore this connection in a photo-based assignment where students distill a key moment in history into three tableaus, each of which are photographed and presented to the class. Tableaus have varied from women standing defiantly with placards, a gest of suffrage, to a happy lesbian bride smiling for her wedding portrait, a gest of marriage equality, to a young boy staring dreamily up at the moon, a gest capturing the optimism of early space travel and the feeling of the 1950s U.S. When carrying out these kinds of assignments, it's important, I think, that devisers once again pay close attention to the dangers of reinscribing stable binaries of self and other, of past and present. Rather than proving our superiority over our less evolved ancestors, it's essential that we acknowledge how unstable our own footing is, how uncertain we are about the ideological webs which entangle us today. By performing this uncertainty, devisers can fulfill the real promise of Brechtian alienation, lining up the process-based nature of theater with a political philosophy that values contingency and doubt. We need to encourage emerging performers to embrace the messy, the jagged, the unstable, and the incomplete. And we need to embrace these forms, not only because they will produce more compelling theater, but because they are the key to unlocking more just and equitable futures.